views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hello and welcome to Open BXRx, BronxNet's special coverage providing you the latest information, resources, services, and community efforts taking place locally here in the Bronx and virtually during the pandemic. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, and today is Tuesday, January 19th. Coming up, Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield presents The Whole Health Report, a new monthly feature providing insights into how we can be healthier here in the Bronx. This month, we discuss underlying conditions and COVID-19. Then, scams are at an all-time high during the pandemic. Director Kraninger of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau joins us to share some common COVID-19-related scams and tips to stay safe. After that, we'll share how the Bronx Edulution continues ensuring hashtag equity for all by providing educational content through a partnership between BronxNet and educators, artists, and community members across the Bronx. And January is National Blood Donors Month. We'll share how New York Blood Center provides a safe, sanitized donation experience, and we'll also learn about the COVID convalescent plasma and how you can help in the fight against COVID-19. So please, stick around. Open BXRx starts now. Welcome to Open BXRx on BronxNet. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, inviting you to get social with us at BronxNet TV on Instagram and Twitter and BronxNet Community Television on Facebook. This week, we have a new feature here on Open BXRx, where medical professionals join us to provide insight on how you can be healthier. Welcome to The Whole Health Report, sponsored by Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield. Today on The Whole Health Report, we're discussing the risk of COVID-19 for people with underlying conditions. I'm happy to welcome Dr. Craig Hersh, the Chief Medical Officer at Empire, and Jasmyn Rosales, Social Work Case Manager at Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield. Dr. Hersh, Jasmyn, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you for having us.
Of course. First off, Dr. Hersh, can you please tell me more about why Empire decided to team up with BronxNet for this whole health report in order to discuss health issues here in the Bronx?
Absolutely. So our mission at Empire is to materially and measurably improve the health of all New Yorkers. And we say to ourselves, where better to do this than right here in the Bronx? Teaming up with you and BronxNet gives us an opportunity to reach people that we really want to be in touch with so we can be part of the solution.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hersh. And we're happy to partner with Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield to have this incredible platform for our residents, you know, especially during this time. We know that our borough is especially challenged by health issues, Dr. Hersh, probably more so than many of other boroughs and surrounding New York communities. Can you tell us more about these health issues here in the Bronx?
Yes, no, you're right. So the Bronx is challenged. You have a higher incidence historically of medical conditions that are considered chronic, things like asthma, diabetes, high blood pressure. And those things only became worse during the pandemic. The Bronx tends to have worse outcomes for those conditions overall, even before a pandemic. Of 62 counties in the state of New York, the Bronx ranks 62 when it comes to health outcomes. So there's plenty of work to be done.
Right. And Dr. Hersh, how has COVID-19 exactly exacerbated these health issues? What are some of the most common underlying conditions besides asthma and diabetes? And how have people with these conditions been affected through the pandemic?
Yeah, it's affected it in a couple of different ways. First off, especially during 2020, it made it very difficult to access care. And so other conditions that people have may have festered a little bit or gotten worse. The second thing is that COVID brought about illness upon illness. So if you had these underlying conditions, you were much more likely to have a worse outcome. I'll give you a couple examples. When we talk about diabetes, which is highly prevalent in the Bronx, the mortality rate, the death rate increased by 24% in 2020. And when we talk about high blood pressure, the mortality rate increased by 40%. So these were unexpected things that we were going to see as a result of COVID. Now, we also saw from COVID itself, you know, more significant outcomes in the Bronx than in some of the other boroughs. And part of the reason for that is there's a high density of population. There's a lot of people living in multi-generational homes, and there's a lot of people serving on the front lines. And you put all those together and it's sort of a recipe for spread of the virus.
Some very staggering statistics. Thank you for sharing, Dr. Hersh. I want to learn, how does Empire and your team help people here in the Bronx get the help that they need, especially during these times?
Right. So that's the secret sauce, right? And we help in ways big and small. And sometimes it's strictly on the medical side. So maybe someone has trouble filling a prescription or taking their medicine, or sometimes they have trouble accessing care. But oftentimes it's the things around the care, the emotional, the social, the financial, things that contribute to bad health outcomes. Our case managers and social workers have done some incredible things, some amazing things. I've seen them work with patients who have something like asthma, multiple visits to the emergency room, multiple admissions, and they can't figure out what's going on. And as we peel back the onion and we work with those folks and get to know them, what you find out is sometimes it's environmental factors. Sometimes it's mold in the home, and they're not exactly sure how to remediate that. And as we start working with them, we're able to help and help solve those kind of problems.
And, you know, that brings us right to our next guest here. Jasmyn is one of those social case manager workers at Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield. Jasmyn, thank you so much for joining us. I wanted to ask you to tell us about your work as a social worker here in the Bronx. Dr. Hersh kind of, you know, touched upon what some of those issues are that maybe residents are not sure of, but you help them, you know, get through that. Can you talk about, you know, being from the Bronx and also working here in the Bronx as a social worker?
Of course, thank you so much for having me. So my job here as a social worker in the Bronx is definitely a daily adventure. I mean, I love every bit of it. Bronx is my second home. I'm originally from the Windy City of Chicago. I moved to the Bronx a while back, and it reminds me of home. I mean, I grew up in a low-income neighborhood where resources were very little, and unfortunately, the health conditions were at an all-time high. Nonetheless, I am a Bronxite and a New Yorker at heart. So my role actually entails helping our members, especially mi gente of the Bronx, with linking them to community resources.
And Jasmyn, can you share some of those resources and services that you typically provide Bronxites with?
Oh, sure. So as Dr. Hersh mentioned, you know, there's a lot of like psychosocial factors that exacerbate health conditions, and one of them, and I help Bronxites members with applying for transportation, medical transportation through AccessoRide and other local transportation companies. I assist and help them with applying for low-income housing, or help them with their current situation, housing situation that can entail from mold removal, some maintenance issues. I call on their behalf to their mortgage companies to enroll them in financial hardship programs. I'm able to assist them apply for financial assistance through various New York City organizations for our members that are diagnosed with core conditions such as asthma, cancer, diabetes, and so forth. Making sure that their gas and lights and electricity are not cut off by calling their prospective electricity companies and helping them with the financial assistance there. Linking them to food assistance through community organizations such as Get Food NYC or local food pantries, helping them with lower cost prescription programs for, especially for our asthma diabetes members, since Bronx has the highest percentage of diabetes members, which is at 16% right now, or since the pandemic, basically. And then we have applying for Social Security disability and Medicare. I mean, the list can go on, Sonji. You know, it can definitely go on.
No, you know, social work is super important, especially during these times. And even before it, as you and Dr. Hersh mentioned, Jasmyn, you know, these issues have already existed in our communities here in the Bronx. So, you know, thank you to Empire for providing all these services and resources to our community. I wanted to also ask you, how has COVID-19 impacted your work? And, you know, how has it changed for you as a social worker?
Well, where do I even start? I mean, COVID-19 has definitely, you know, the assistance and the need has tremendously greatly increased. More members are in need. They're more vulnerable than ever. outside of the resources that I just named, I believe like financial assistance has doubled for our Bronx Sites members, as well as linking them to community outpatient mental health treatments. See, my mantra is, I don't believe in saying no, Sonyi. Like, I will exhaust every option. I will advocate to ensure that Bronx Sites members are linked to resources to help them with their daily functioning. If I could just alleviate one stressor for one member, then I have done my job.
That's the Bronx mentality right there. You know, that's why
there you go.
We accept you and we welcome you into our community. So thank you. Dr. Hersh, I want to loop you back into the conversation. Our viewers may be listening at home and they want to know where they can access these resources. Can you provide, you know, any access to the information, any resource links and more? Also, COVID-19 vaccine updates, doctor. We want to take advantage of having you here.
Yeah, so everyone's concerned very much about the COVID vaccines right now. And the first thing I want to say is I strongly encourage everybody who's eligible to go and get that vaccine. It is a sort of shifting table right now. It's hard to know exactly where to go. Resources are helpful. I would highly recommend that people go to nyc.gov. The other place that I would recommend people check is empireblue.com. And you can always call 311 as well. So in any way that we can be helpful to you, like Jasmyn said, we'll be there to help you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hersh. Dr. Craig Hersh, the Chief Medical Officer at Empire, and Jasmyn Rosales, Social Work Case Manager at Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield. Again, this is a new Whole Health Report, a partnership sponsored by Empire Blue Cross Blue Shield. Dr. Hersh will be joining us a little more regularly every month, providing you health updates regarding, you know, COVID-19 and other conditions here in the Bronx, information that you need. So thank you both again for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Again, we look forward to having you back, Dr. Hersh, at the Whole Health Report from Empire. Thank you both. We'll be right back.
We know that people are dealing with the health crisis, but there's also a lot of food insecurity.
We're giving out healthy food options, and that's what's key here.
If you're a senior, you have a disability, they'll actually deliver meals to you.
The residents are anxious, they're worried, they're scared, they want to be tested.
When things were happening in our community, and we couldn't get the help.
There's almost a presumption of criminality that attaches to your skin color.
The site will prioritize those who are at highest risk in the population.
If you feel symptoms and you'd like to visit one of these COVID-19 testing sites here in the Bronx, you may call the State Health Department's hotline.
Important to note about this site is no reservations are needed. This is a walk-in clinic.
A lot of us are out of work and looking for something to do.
We have the machinery and the skills to make large scales of these masks and gowns.
Take care of your people. It's going to go way further than we actually can understand.
Right now, employees like myself are just adjusting
to the new reality.
Reporting from Bronx Net, this is Marisol Tran.
This should not be behavior that's reflected upon leadership in our borough, and we must stand against it in every which way, whoever it is.
Assemblymember Natalia Fernandez voiced her thoughts on the recent arrest of Bronx Senator Luis Sepulveda for allegedly choking his wife.
This behavior is not going to be tolerated anymore. You know, these are, again, all have been strong allegations that need to be taken seriously, give women the power to speak on them and to fight against them.
Police say Sepulveda and his wife got into a physical fight on January 9th at 5:45 in the morning at their home in West Farms, where he allegedly wrapped his hands around her neck. Sepulveda also filed a complaint against his wife, claiming that she punched him. We spoke with Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, who recounted his previous interactions with Sepulveda's wife.
I'll take her at her word. I know her. She's an incredibly nice person. She has a heart of gold, and I can only imagine what she's suffering right now.
Sepulveda turned himself into the 48th precinct on Tuesday morning and is now facing charges for criminal obstruction of breathing.
There is no context here in which he could have the confidence of the community, of people, of women in particular.
Senate Majority Leader Andrea Stewart-Cousins announced that Sepulveda will be immediately removed as chair of the chamber's Crime and Victim Unit and from other committee assignments. Stewart-Cousins released a statement saying, in part, "I take these allegations extremely seriously and will be monitoring the situation closely."
For him to abuse that trust, we're supposed to be above reproach. We're supposed to stand and be a role model in our homes and in private and in public. For that to happen is very painful to watch.
Sepulveda's lawyer, Marvin Ray Raskin, released a statement claiming that Sepulveda has been a victim of violence for 9 years and said in part, "This false accusation is a calculated attempt by a disgruntled party to leverage a divorce settlement for a case she filed in Florida this past November."
The best thing that he could do for himself, for his family, he has a child, and for the community is to resign and to do it today.
Now, if Senator Sepulveda steps down, a special election will take place to replace his seat. Councilmember Cabrera reminds those running for office that the position is pressure-filled, and all candidates will be held to a higher standard. Reporting for BronxNet, Jericho Tran.
Welcome back. Scammers often take advantage of vulnerable people during times of crises and distress. In fact, as of January 3rd, the Federal Trade Commission, or FTC, had logged more than 298,000 consumer complaints related to COVID-19 and stimulus payments, 68% of them involving fraud or identity theft. Joining us now to share some common COVID-19 related scams and tips to stay safe is Kathy Kraninger, Director of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Welcome, Kathy, Director Kraninger. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, Sanjay. It's an honor to be here.
Of course. So first to start off, can you just tell us a little bit about the CFPB and the Bureau's goal?
Absolutely. The CFPB is about 10 years old. It was created in the response to the financial crisis, specifically to look out for consumers of consumer financial products. So mortgages, student loans, auto loans. We work with the Federal Trade Commission, certainly very closely. We have some overlaps in authority with them, but we also have our own unique authorities to bring to bear. So our job is to prevent consumer harm in this space. So we do that through educating, like we're going to do today, making sure that there are resources available to consumers, issuing regulations so industry knows what the rules are and what they're required to do. We supervise, so we send some of our staff in to go look at what financial institutions are doing and make sure they're doing the right thing. And enforcement. We absolutely sue companies who are bad actors, and we get redress and restitution, you know, money back to consumers who have been harmed, or we penalize those companies. So that's what the CFPB does.
Thank you so much, Director, for the background. Now, as we know, throughout the pandemic, a lot of folks have been home more often. So scammers know exactly how to contact and prey on the vulnerable through phone, whether that be through text or email. Can you please share the rise in scams and why this is happening during the COVID-19 pandemic?
Hey, scammers are always going to be opportunists, taking advantage of whatever is available to them to try to trick people, get access to their money. And certainly the pandemic is no different. People are scared. They might not have right access to information. They feel a little isolated, certainly because of the stay-at-home orders and otherwise to keep people safe. So scammers take advantage of that. They'll suggest they have a vaccine for you, or if you just sign up and send this amount of money, you know, they'll get you a vaccine or a treatment. So it's really a fraudulent activity that they're just taking advantage of that. So some of the scams that we see are, you know, saying that they're the government, and if you just give them something, you know, they'll help you get your stimulus check, for example. Or saying that there is, you know, a medical provider and they can get you easier access to the vaccine. Really, the best way to know that this is what's going on is the information they ask you for. They start asking you for a Medicare number, a Social Security number, a bank account number. You know, never give that to anyone. There's no government entity that's going to call you out of the blue and ask you for that information. So those are some of the key indicators about, you know, how to know this is what's going on. And as you pointed out, Sanji, they're using every means. So they'll be at your door, they'll call, they'll email, they'll text. And it's really critically important to make sure that you stop and think in the middle of those kinds of discussions.
Got it. Thank you, Director Kraninger. Also, according to the U.S. government officials, COVID-19 vaccine scams, as you said, are recently on the rise during the pandemic. Can you tell us what consumers exactly should be watching out for regarding this particular scam?
Yeah. Yeah, this is it's very much the same thing. Again, trying to offer you something by frankly getting you to pay them. A lot of these scams involve saying, you know, hey, if you just give us this down payment, or you go and get gift cards or pay with prepaid or gift cards, those are one-time use. The minute that they get a hold of those kinds of payments, there is not much of a means to get that money back. So those are the kinds of things that they're often looking for. They may tell you it's to help someone else or a charitable organization that they're standing up to help someone or that someone you know is in trouble. So those are the kinds of things, but it's really, again, making sure you guard your personal information, that you know the source that's calling you to or that's emailing you. Don't just click without thinking. There are ways to know if a company is legitimate, like going to the internet and searching for the actual company, you know, like your credit card company, if they say that they're a credit card company. Rather than clicking on whatever that link is, go to those bank websites and verify that you're actually getting this contact from a legitimate source. Odds are, though, again, if they're asking you for this kind of personal information, it's not a legitimate source.
Are some of our most popular, you know, demographic, maybe the elderly, how can, you know, a younger person help, you know, their grandparent through this issue, through these scams? I feel like a lot of grandparents may not be tech savvy. They, you know, they're not sure where to go for this help and these resources. How can we help our older population?
That is an excellent point. And again, you know, it's already a community, the elderly who are isolated often, you know, due to illnesses or otherwise, and the pandemic has really exacerbated that and made it worse. So really, as those who care about our loved ones, making sure that they just don't take those calls. You know, if they get somebody who's talking to them, they can say, oh, let me take your phone number down. Let me take your contact information down. I'll have my family member call you, you know, just to say, you know, remind them, never provide that kind of information on the phone. Absolutely, these scammers are seeking to build a relationship and prey on those who are feeling that loneliness and isolation. And so a reminder is critically important to all of those who may be experiencing these kinds of scams.
Are scams also sent through the mail, maybe, you know, in a letter or something like that? What are other mediums of scams being?
Oh, absolutely. As I said, opportunistic ways to take advantage of people any way you can. You will get them through the mail. You could get them by phone or text or email. Again, advertisements, you know, something you might click on. It's like, oh, donate to this cause, or, you know, those are all things that could be seeking to pull you to a place where they're going to start asking you for information that really you shouldn't be providing. So those are all things to be wary of and be careful of. I mean, look, again, in the busy speed of things, I've had that situation. It looks legitimate. You know, you think it's from Apple or you think it's from Amazon and, oh, my order's not going to come on time. And all of a sudden you start digging in and they start asking you for information. And it's not the company they purport to be. It's not the purpose that they're claiming it is. We really just need to be very careful and report it. I can tell you it's incredibly hard to take enforcement action against these entities. A lot of them are overseas, operating overseas from safe haven countries. So they're looking to get that money out of the country and looking to evade U.S. government prosecution. But we do have ways you can report that to us. Here at the CFPB, we've got a complaint system to report it to. The Federal Trade Commission also has their fraud alert system that you can send information to there as well. So making sure that you tell us what that is, and we'll continue to work together to try to clamp down on that. But it really is an important first line of defense to save you from the heartache and trouble of even engaging with these scammers.
Perfect. I saw a great clip virtually through the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau's Twitter. Director, I would like you to share maybe three comprehensive tips for our viewers right now. You know, just to backtrack and remember, what are the three steps to keep them safe during these scams?
Yeah, happy to do that. Again, we have so much at cfpb.gov/coronavirus. In general, at our website to educate folks. So I suppose the number one tip is if you have any questions or are looking for information, come to cfpb.gov. Absolutely to answer those kinds of questions. We have all kinds of things for you and tips. The second thing is, again, just be wary. Anyone that contacts you out of the blue, there's no reason to be providing any personal information, no reason why they should be asking you for it. So certainly then that third thing is, again, second thing, be wary. Third thing is just don't provide it, don't answer it. Always go to the trusted, you know, source online, to that company's website directly, to that 800 number on the back of your credit card. You know, don't provide that information to someone out of the blue.
Thank you so much. Director Kathy Kraninger is the director for the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Thank you again for your time today.
Thank you so much, Sonyi. Thank you for having me.
Of course. Folks, again, you can visit consumerfinance.gov to learn how you can protect yourself financially. If you or someone you know has experienced a scam, you can also report it to the reportfraud.ftc.gov website. We'll be right back.
Who's most at risk for coronavirus? People over 65, people with underlying medical conditions like heart disease, chronic lung disease, asthma, diabetes, people undergoing cancer treatment, and people with weakened immune systems. What should you do if you or a loved one is at higher risk? Avoid close contact with people. Avoid crowds. Stay home if you can. Wash your hands frequently. Learn more ways to protect yourself and others at coronavirus.gov.
With over 300,000 New Yorkers having received COVID-19 vaccinations, Mayor Bill de Blasio recently announced that Bronxites can expect Yankee Stadium to serve as a mass vaccination site. This move is part of the mayor's push to set up 250 vaccination locations to meet the ambitious goal of inoculating 1 million New Yorkers by the end of January.
We are opening up 24/7 megasites. We talked yesterday about Citi Field, and again, thanks to the New York Mets for stepping up. That's fantastic. That's going to serve a lot of people. Well, we've heard back from the New York Yankees. We welcome them into the fold too. We're working with them now to work out a plan to use Yankee Stadium as well. And that's going to be great for the people of the Bronx.
The announcement comes after community leaders, including the 161st Street Bid, campaigned for Yankee Stadium to join sports teams like the Mets, who expect to offer mass vaccination at Citi Field in Queens later this month.
There is an organic relationship between the Yankees and the Bronx. They call themselves the Bronx Bombers, for goodness sakes. So there's got to be this sort of give and take and effort to support. And now with the vaccination venue being on the verge of opening, we're delighted because they have a staff there of folks from the security people to the attendants to the management that can make this happen very effectively and very peacefully and safely.
The Bronx has seen some of the highest numbers of COVID infections, with 906 newly reported COVID-19 cases and 7 newly reported COVID-19 deaths since January 10th. So far, there are over 40 vaccination sites in the borough, with more expected to come, according to Mayor de Blasio.
The Bronx, and especially the South Bronx, have been so ravaged, decimated by this disease, that a move like this, giving Bronx sites and people especially who live within the South Bronx neighborhoods of Melrose, Morrisania, Highbridge, Concourse, an opportunity to get the vaccine as easily and quickly as it can be done. It's fabulous. It's wonderful.
The mayor's main concern, keeping up with supply and demand.
We will run out of vaccine at some point next week unless we get a major new resupply, because so many New Yorkers want the vaccine and we have the ability to give it to them.
Plans to open the Yankee Stadium mass vaccination site here in the Bronx have yet to be revealed. In the meantime, 24-hour vaccination sites have opened in all five boroughs. You may check your eligibility status for the COVID-19 vaccine and make an appointment at a site near you by visiting nyc.gov/vaccinefinder or calling 877-VAX4NYC. Reporting for BronxNet, Sonyi Lopez.
Welcome back. The Bronx Edulution features educational content through a partnership between BronxNet and educators, artists, and community members across the Bronx. In order to continue ensuring hashtag equity for all during remote learning, new episodes have begun airing for you and your family to enjoy right here on your BronxNet channels and on the web. Joining us now to tell us more are Bronx educator Vanessa Veerasammy and principal of PS110 Marisol Feijoo. Thank you so much for joining us, ladies.
Thank you.
Of course.
Thank you.
Of course. So first to start off, can you tell us about the Bronx Edulution and how and why it was launched at the beginning of the pandemic?
So the Bronx Edulution was created through a partnership between BronxNet and the educators, along with our community members in the Bronx. And it has a great deal of educational content for students and our families. So this all started, or it was birthed during the beginning of the pandemic of March of 2020. Once we received the message that our school buildings were closing and we had to transition to remote, we had to think quick. How are we going to provide our students with instruction and equitable and in an equitable and engaging way?
Thank you for sharing, Ms. Veerasammy. And of course, COVID-19 has exacerbated the lack of digital equity in our communities. And the digital divide is something that we often speak about on our show. Can you just tell us how this has continued to impact both students and educators here in the Bronx? As educators yourself, you would be, you know, the best folks to ask about this.
I think that nobody could have forecast the impact of COVID-19. And clearly before the pandemic, there were many inequities that existed within our community in terms of access to technology, and access being not just having possession of a device, but really understanding how to log in, participate in technology, right? So everything related to it. So one of the things that we realized, that the world, I would say, realized, that came to the forefront was this equity issue when it came to our families and our communities. So, Principal Louis Torres, being a pioneer in his staff at PS55, really, brought to the forefront the importance of having a partnership with BronxNet, and not just within one school, but providing it within our entire district. So in PS110, you know, we share the similar community, similar population, and, the opportunity for our families to know that not only is it the school that, you know, can provide some of the supports for their access and to continue the education of their kids at home during this time, but also that they had access to BronxNet and in a different avenue where they can be provided with videos, anything from content related, so read aloud. Math lessons, science experiments, but also more of a social emotional focus areas as well. So, moving towards like cooking together and activities during this pandemic that you can engage in with your families at home, since we are all pretty much at home, and also some other activities and exercises that will continue, that are part of this learning process, but are not necessarily what you would consider just standard lessons, content area lessons.
Thank you, Principal Feijoo. And I think the, you know, the programming on Bronx Education is wonderful. And for the family, for the entire family, really, it cheered me up, especially during the beginning of the pandemic, to see, you know, teachers and educators like Ms. Veerasammy, for instance, who has her story time. Can you tell us a little bit more about your show in particular and the rest of the content that airs on the Bronx Education, Ms. Veerasammy?
Yes. So Story Time with Ms. Veerasammy features myself, my daughter, and also a puppet called Dr. Adams. So my read alouds are interactive. We take the students on a virtual journey and we explore everything literacy, such as we focus on vocabulary words and writing and thinking and learning about homonyms and homophones and you know, things that you learn in the classroom, but now in a more fun and interactive way virtually. In addition to that, Edulution channel, as Ms. Marisol was speaking of, there are instructional videos that are in different content areas, such as math, there's science, there's social studies, and even the cooking arts, the list goes on. And you might tune in and see a science teacher doing a STEM experiment, which is really cool. And then what's really great about that is because now the students can submit their work and have it seen on BronxNet Edulution channel. Ooh. So it provides a really good opportunity for our families.
That's amazing. And what has the reception been from parents and students who watch and depend on this educational programming from home?
So the parents and the students especially, they love that they're able to turn on the channel and they're like, that's my teacher, or that's my school, or even, oh my goodness, that's my work that I submitted. So having that sense of familiarity and being able to relate.
That's amazing. And you know, as we know, BronxNet airs on cable and online as well. Roughly how many families do you estimate have access to this content? And what does it mean to educators like yourselves to reach the Bronx and beyond through this programming?
I think it's very meaningful. Most of our families do have access. It's And not only, as we were saying before, you know, it started, you know, kind of, it was spearheaded in one area, one location, but it's really expanding now across the Bronx with different schools now participating in, you know, submission of content and videos across the district. So providing even more expansive access to our Bronx families from different neighborhoods. And that's something that's great to see, just the evolution of the evolution across the Bronx. And our families and the reception I've gotten from families at my school in particular is similar to what Vanessa was saying. It's, oh, okay, this is great. I recognize, you know, that's my teacher. but also having content that is accessible and relatable. So, you know, and also fun. You know, we have to really remember to infuse that joy, given the severity of the pandemic and how it's impacted all of us. So to be able to turn on programming that is accessible and then and participate in activities that bring joy into this situation is absolutely amazing. And I'm excited to just be a participant in terms of the expansion of the programming across the Bronx.
And for you both, what is the current situation at your individual schools? I know Principal Feijoo is at PS 110 and Ms. Veerasammy is over at PS 55. Are the schools fully remote, in person? Is there a merge of the two? How's it going over in your individual schools?
So currently at CS 55, we have students who are remote and then we have students who are on an AP schedule. They do a blended learning.
At PS 110, approximately 65% of our student population is fully remote currently. And the remaining population is, we started off with a hybrid model of, you know, 2 days in person, 3 days remote and vice versa. And as of January 4th, all our classes are 5 days a week in person. However, the reality is that when you have multiple confirmed cases within the building, the school building does close down. And that's when all families have to transition back to fully remote. So that's the reality we have been facing as school leaders.
Thank you both so much for joining us today. And before we go, I just want to invite families and students and parents and teachers to tune in to the wonderful Bronx Edulution, the new season that's coming up. And, you know, also thank you and the many teachers and educators and Principal Luis Torres, the Bronx principal, for, you know, spearheading this effort and this initiative with BronxNet. So, you know, thank you all so much for putting your love and your time and your energy into this incredible project. Without further ado, where can people tune in? How can they find out more and all that good stuff?
So Monday through Friday, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m., BronxNet channel 67 and 70 optimum, and also 2133 and 2136 on Fios.
Perfect. Thank you so much. One last thing. If each of you can just provide a quick message to students and parents and even your fellow educators during these times.
I just would like to say that, you know, to remember to just keep moving forward. We have learned to be flexible, and with everything that is a challenge, there comes a new opportunity for growth and for learning, as we saw now just with Bronx Evolution that evolved as a result of this pandemic. So just to keep your head up, you know, keep looking forward and know that we're all in this together, and we will surpass and overcome this together as well and come out stronger as a result.
Absolutely, absolutely. And also stay Bronx strong.
Thank you both so much. Principal of PS 110, Marisol Feijoo, and Miss Vanessa Veerasammy is an educator here in the Bronx at CS 55. Thank you both again for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right.
Again, new episodes of the Bronx Edulution began airing again beginning Monday, January 11th. You can tune in to the Bronx Edulution on BronxNet Channel 67 Optimum, 2133 Files, and 70 Optimum, 2136 Files in the Bronx, and also online at bronxnet.tv Monday through Friday at 3 p.m. We'll be right back with OpenBXRx.
A media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Most at risk for coronavirus? People over 65, people with underlying medical conditions like heart disease, chronic lung disease, asthma, diabetes, people undergoing cancer treatment, and people with weakened immune systems. What should you do if you or a loved one is at higher risk? Avoid close contact with people. Avoid crowds. Stay home if you can. Wash your hands frequently. Learn more ways to protect yourself and others at coronavirus.gov.
Here at the Bronx coronavirus vaccination megasite, people walked in and out to receive their vaccine. This is just a few days after New Yorkers waited in long lines before the city progressed its vaccine distribution efforts.
It was so nice. I came here, I saw a lot of people are taking it, and I was so excited. So I was asking the doctor, like, what kind of side effects gonna happen? But he said, nothing gonna happen, but hope that a pain, a little sore will be tomorrow.
In New York City, only about 23,000 people have received both doses of the vaccine as of Tuesday. Now, state officials say those that are 65 and older are eligible to receive the vaccine, making it an even greater demand.
Regardless of your health situation, obviously you're vulnerable. We've talked about this before. You have the right to be vaccinated. You can sign up now.
Feel good. Halfway there.
77-year-old Bronxite Tom Loeb did not hesitate to get the vaccine once his age group was eligible. This change went into effect immediately on Tuesday. New Yorkers in Phase 1A and now Phase 1B can get the vaccine by appointment only. This new expanded criteria will open up vaccinations to at least 1.8 million more New York State residents.
It's a great experience. I expected 4 hours. I had 15 minutes. It was amazing. Oh, I'm going to be 82 in about 2 weeks. So I figured it's time to get it vaccinated. When they said over 75, I'm over 75. So I got it.
Group 1B includes people 65 years of age or older, first responders, teachers, and transit workers. CDC are now working on new federal guidelines to get immunocompromised individuals eligible for vaccinations. You can check out the full list of who's eligible for a vaccine at covid19vaccine.health.nyu.gov. Reporting for BronxNet, Ashley Tiffany.
Welcome back. January is National Blood Donor Month. Since the outbreak of COVID-19, there have been severe blood shortages in New York and throughout the country over concerns that it may not be safe to go to blood donation centers. However, New York State is strongly encouraging eligible and healthy New Yorkers to donate life-saving blood. How safe is it to donate blood right now? What is the COVID convalescent plasma? Here to address these concerns and more is Andrea Cefarelli, Senior Executive Director of the New York Blood Center. Welcome, Andrea. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate the invitation.
Of course. Just to start off, can you just please tell us about the New York Blood Center and your mission?
Sure. New York Blood Center has been around for 55 years, and we serve over 200 hospitals with life-saving blood and blood products. And of course, blood is perishable, so we need volunteer blood donors and platelet donors and convalescent plasma donors coming in, despite the fact that it's a pandemic and our lives are upside down.
And how has that process been affected by COVID-19, Andrea? Can you just share how donations have been impacted during this time?
Sure. So pre-pandemic, 75% of our blood donations came from blood drives hosted in the community at churches, high schools, colleges, businesses. So it was very easy to give blood. You had the convenience factor of donating with your classmates or with your coworkers and just popping down the hallway to donate in the cafeteria or somewhere convenient. And then we lost all blood drives early in the pandemic, and then summer we started trying to rebuild. So giving blood, where people give blood is different. We have 19 donor centers across our footprint, which is in New York, upstate New York, Long Island, and into New Jersey. And slowly we've been trying to add more blood drives. Then we've gone to extraordinary measures to make sure that people feel safe to donate blood. Both our staff and the donors that we rely on to provide these life-saving products to hospitals and ultimately to the patients who need the blood. So to begin with, pre-pandemic, you could just walk into a blood drive if you saw a sign. And now we are about 90% appointment only, which is really nice. We love that. We've been trying to do that for years. But make an appointment at nybc.org so we can expect you. Then we take your temperature before you enter. You must have a face covering. We clean our tablets, which is where you register between donors. We clean our donor beds. Our staff, of course, are in masks, and the appointments allow for us to keep donors, you know, socially distanced throughout the process.
Got it. So it is a safe process during this time for those who are concerned back at home, may want to donate, but are not really sure, Andrea?
Yes. And donors have been amazing. Donors are coming out, but just not enough. There was a chronic deficit in blood donations, I think because of that convenience factor. It's not so easy. And some of that fear and staying from home. The good news is that gradually we've been increasing donations, and in December had our largest month, but there's still a gap between what we need and how many are donating.
Andrea, who is eligible to donate as a healthy donor? Who would meet those requisites?
So in general, well and healthy, of course, you can't have any symptoms of a cold or flu or COVID-19. You can get the general criteria on our website at nybc.org. If you've had a tattoo or a piercing, there can be a wait. Some travel. So pre-COVID travel, we were looking for exposure to malaria and things like that. Now travel restrictions are more related to COVID, but 90% of that is on our website. So if you're feeling well and healthy, you bring your ID, you make your appointment, and most people are surprised to find not only are they eligible, but the process is relatively seamless. And most first-time donors say, well, that was easier than I thought.
Got it. And something you mentioned earlier is the COVID convalescent plasma, CP. What is it and how is it different from just donating blood?
Sure. So New York Blood Center, we're extremely proud that we were the first in the country to collect convalescent plasma, which is used to treat those battling COVID-19 right now. And so convalescent plasma comes from people that had COVID-19, recovered, feeling well and healthy, and at least 14 days symptom-free. And then they have special plasma, so they come in and donate convalescent plasma that is then used for someone battling COVID-19. You have to go through our website for that because there's special requirements for proof of a COVID test or an antibody test and details about your symptoms. And so you upload your details and we'll call you within 24 to 48 hours and give you a ton of convenient places to donate. You can donate up to 8 times 1 week apart. And then after those eight donations, and there are several people that have done that, you then can donate monthly. So.
And does the process hurt? Is it painful at all, Andrea, just for anyone who may want to know that at home?
No, very similar to donating blood. In fact, donating blood, the needle's a little bigger. It's all a needle. And like I said, most first-time donors say that isn't bad. Actually, the convalescent plasma needle is a little bit smaller, but a slightly longer procedure to donate convalescent plasma. Most donors can donate 3 products, which can help up 3 patients. Because your body has more plasma than red cells.
Got it. Something else that the New York Blood Center offers is antibody testing. Can you tell us about that process and also what antibody testing is?
So we will tell you if you have the presence, yes or no, of antibodies. There's, if you go on the web or just ask that question, what does that mean? There's so many opinions. So we just say yes or no, you do or you do not have the presence of antibodies. Some people will say, well, you give us our titer, which could be a count. We don't do any of that. The primary reason is because donors want to know that. And 2, it also helps us to identify potential convalescent plasma donors. So it's a value to the individual donor. And it's also a value where we say, hey, did you know you have the antibodies? Would you like to become a convalescent plasma donor?
Got it. Thank you, Andrea. And one more thing. What is the importance of donating blood, especially during the COVID-19 pandemic and even, you know, beyond and before it as well?
Yeah, so red cells last 42 days. So, you know, if everybody in the world donated today, 42 days from now, we'd be out. So it's about a constant supply of blood donations. And they're needed for cancer patients, leukemia patients, sickle cell, surgeries, think newborn babies. And, you know, people can donate 5 or 6 times a year, and yet 75% of the population never gives blood. So, you know, not only do we need it for COVID patients with convalescent plasma, and some of them are even getting other products, but everyone else who's kind of on hold for cancer patient treatment, you know, these people need blood despite the fact that it's a pandemic. So it's a life-saving gift that you can give for an hour of your time.
And how can people get in touch with the New York Blood Center and find out more to support NYBC at this time, Andrea?
Yeah, so the easiest way with your phone, nybc.org, we have a zip code and blood drive locator. You can just quick make an appointment if you're a regular donor, or nybc.org and check out convalescent plasma. Or if you just want to call us, 1-800-933-2566, and we'll make your appointment for you.
One more thing again, just a reminder that it is absolutely safe to donate blood at this time.
In case absolutely safe. Work. And the final thing that I would say is if you have a location and you would like to host a blood drive, that's another great way that you can help. Like I said, we have fewer locations, and some places have donated their space once a month, once a week. It's safe to host a blood drive right now. So we don't have 550 like we did pre-pandemic, but we're up to about 300. So if you have a church or a business or just an idea, give us a call. You can fill out the form on the website or call that same number and we'll brainstorm with you. So lots of ways to help us.
Thank you again, Andrea, for your time.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your support.
Of course.
Happy New Year.
You as well. Happy New Year. Andrea Cefarelli is the Senior Executive Director at the New York Blood Center. Again, healthy blood donors can schedule an appointment to donate blood by visiting the New York Blood Center website at nybc.org or calling 212-570-3000. That's all for our show today. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, wishing you and your family safety and wellness now and always. Take care.